The idea that every town should have some sort of space to reflect on its local history for educational purposes was of interest. So we jumped at the chance to, you know, get the machine shop because it was really the last vestige of the working waterfront in Hoboken. The machine shop was built in 1890. It's the oldest building on the Hoboken waterfront, and it is the only surviving building of what was known as the W&A Fletcher Shipyard. They were known for building walking beam engines and then later introducing steam turbine engines to this country. You principally had them building what they called dayliners, and these were huge commercial passenger ships that went up and down the Hudson. Generally, they didn't make the hull here, but the hull would come into the yard and all the fancy woodwork, the interiors, all the craftsmen and artisans that would have been used to sort of decorate them were here, and of course the engine. The Bethlehem Steel Shipyard took over the yard in 1938. The plant was expanded at different times, so the building, there are certain areas where you can see there are wood beams and then steel beams next to them, so it sort of shows the change of materials and how the building was able to sort of transcend, you know, its first years in the 1890s and still be very important for the shipbuilding trade in World War II. It was the oldest building on the Hoboken waterfront, so it did reflect its working class history.
I've been here all my life. In fact, my father worked here from 1911 until he retired. That was in the late 50s. He brought me in this place in his arms when I was only a youngster.
My father's name was Chico. I became young Chico, and my son became Chico Jr. At one point, we all three worked here. It was nice. It was nice because all three of us in the rigging loft, and it was a very interesting place.
I was about 16 years old. In them days, it was shaping. You had to shape to come up here to find out if there were any work.
They'd have guys come in, machinists, and they would pick so many, like the longshoremen used to do years ago. But with the crane operators and the riggers and that, when I was there, probably before when it was Fletcher's, they did that, you know, shape up.
You could come to work. You had your time card, and if there was enough work, they took your time card. That meant, and then you got it late in that night, and you checked out, and you got paid for the day.
I knew they were hiring women, but I would never go. I was married, I had two little kids, and it never, I think if I was single, maybe I would have tried it, but I would have never come in had they not asked me. If they didn't have the certain percentage of women, you were not able to get government contracts. So when I was here, most of the times there were Navy ships that came in.
I started in 1960 in the shipyard, and I knew nothing about a crane. And the government had a six-month program, so they paid, you know, Bethlehem Steel to train people. You get confidence after a while, you know, so it was easy running the crane after a while. I must have made about over 100 lifts a day. It was a lot of stress. And half the time I couldn't see what I was doing. I had to depend on a rigger to give me the signals, you know, and trust him.
I was classified as a rigger specialist. We were like a service trade. When machinery had to be moved from a ship at the machinist or whatever, we had to come in and get it out. So I'm talking 38, 40 ton pieces of metal.
I was a mobile crane operator, and we had to move gear and all the things around the shipyard to where the men were working on the piers, so they had their equipment with them. The manager would always send for me to move particular items that were worth like hundreds of thousands of dollars. They would be expensive items. They would ask for a woman to move it because I think they thought the women were more careful, and I think we were.
I used to have a ship on this side and a ship on this side. And half of the time, I had more enemies because I couldn't take care of everybody.
You know, a ship never made money laying in a shipyard. It had to be on the way. It's quite an interesting business. You could learn an awful lot here.
When this yard really came alive was during World War II. That's when this yard really became important. You know, there was just so much work involved here, and that was sort of the last big surge.
We went right around the clock here, 7 days a week, reconverting, rebuilding the ships into quarters for crew, for the soldiers and stuff like bunks, sanitary systems. Everything had to be done just right. And then, of course, we had supply ships, too, that carried supplies for troops and ships at sea.
My father didn't get drafted because he was essential here in the yard. And so he was working all during the war here.
You have the machine shop going 24 hours a day. You have over 20,000 people working here. After World War II, a lot of those same ships came back here and were reconverted back into kind of government passenger use, but not military use. So again, there was a lot of work from that.
Oh, we had all denominations here. The carpenters, most of them were Yugoslavians, Polish, you know.
There were divisions of jobs, let's put it this way. The Irish operated the crane.
Usually with the hull department, a lot of Scotch.
There were blacks, Spanish, Italians, Germans, Irish. I think we had every nationality worked in the shipyard.
And it was a lot of nice. They had all different names of people. The one guy's name was Skyfish.
Dirty Neck Louie.
Texas Jack.
Cowboy.
Jesse James.
Jane Paul Willie, he was the snapper.
I knew one man, he was called Hook.
Snowshoe Eddie.
Moneybags John, he worked mostly in the wheel gang.
The U-boat commander.
Oh, we had characters. We had plenty of them.
When the men came out for lunch, there was no room in the stores anymore to eat or the restaurant. They would sit along the building, and it would start from 13th and Hudson, and they would sit all the way around against the buildings. That's how busy it was.
It was sort of like a little city within its city that could survive on its own.
And it looked like an English movie, this area, because the buildings were very close together in little alleyways that you walked through.
There were about 43 buildings on the property. In its heyday, there was also a medical facility here.
We had a dispensary here with a doctor and a male nurse. We were always here around the clock.
It's not very safe. It wasn't very safe. You had to be very careful working in the shipyard. It never was a minor accident. It usually was a very bad accident or fatality.
I believe we did average at least 1 to 2 fatalities a year in this yard alone. You always had a fatality.
Yeah, I mean, it was a dangerous place, but the danger was from stupidity mostly.
We had to be safe, you know. It depended on the men's lives here.
If I thought it was too windy, I didn't care what anybody says, I wouldn't run the crane. If I went to pick up the load, if I didn't think it was hooked up right, I'm not picking it up.
There was some stupidity. Guy one time picked up a rudder from a tanker that was filled with oil and was supposed to be empty. He didn't pay attention. He lifted it up and the crane almost went over. So it bounced and somebody got hurt.
So I had to always make sure, you know, I knew what I was doing and don't get into something you shouldn't. I used to tell the new guys when I broke them in, if you don't think it's right, don't do it.
OSHA came in then and we had to wear glasses and helmets. So that stopped some of it. But you couldn't stop when a guy just forgot and walked into a hole or fell down off the ship.
We had people coming in that never worked in the shipyard. And you had to break these people in. You had to teach them. But it was pretty hard on some of them.
Well, I broke in a lot of them. A lot of them didn't last. I'd break them in, and then when they were supposed to get their license, they didn't show up. It took 6 months, you know, to break in, and you wouldn't see them. They caught up to you after a while. You couldn't stay there too long on, you know. You needed a break.
this shipyard really started to cut back in the 1960s and 70s, and then when government contracts started to be cut back, then you really saw this place start to disintegrate.
First thing that happened was that when Bethlehem was here at the heyday, there was longshoremen that one man lifted one bag and moved it on or off the boat. When containers came in and people started to move to Port Elizabeth and Port Newark and all that, this became a secondary port.
The foreign competition is what hurt us, you know. If they had a ship that was damaged here, they could patch it up temporarily, tow it all the way over to Germany or Japan and get this job done than if they had it done here.
Then the economy changed. A lot of government contracts were cut back, especially, you know, military. And so the shipyard kind of suffered the loss of a lot of contracts that it needed to survive. And the plant did close.
We knew eventually it was going to close because they weren't sending ships here anymore. I think they went to other locations. So we knew that they were going to eventually close. It wasn't a surprise, just we didn't know when.
And it was a sad day, you know. It was a sad night, too, when my father closed the place up, and that was it. And part of the thing that I felt bad about for him was that he had given so many retirement parties, and now he was retiring, and he was the last one. Literally, he had the key to lock up the place and throw it in the drink, and that was it.
I never thought I'd see the shipyard go. When I saw the last crane get torn down out on the pier, then I believed it.
After the cranes, they started tearing the building. The first thing that went was the C building. And I never thought that. That building was like 8 stories, and it had all this material in there that they had for rigging and laborers and tools. And then, boom, it went. And when that went, we knew it was gone.
To me, it didn't matter, but to the men who had their livelihood here, that was their livelihood, they were, you know, upset. It was like part of history being demolished. When they were going to rip this building down, I felt they should keep something. And the machine shop would have been the part to keep. This was a nice building.
Well, I tell you, I'm glad something like this is happening to preserve the memory of the shipyard. Oh, there's a lot of memories here. Yeah, a lot of memories, good and bad.
I had 5 children. I raised them all working in the shipyard. It was a nice job. Once you get used to the smell of the salt water, you don't want to leave it.
But, you know, there was a certain feeling of nostalgia when you walked into like this building. What's nice about it is the fact that they've given it a new life.
It's taken over 12 years, but pretty soon our first exhibit will feature the history of the W&A Fletcher Company and the Bethlehem Steel Shipyard company that was here. So the artifacts that were removed from here will be displayed on these walls. And it's kind of interesting that there had always been the hope that someday we'd be able to display these items.